The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 22736 in the name of Rona Mackay on National Adoption Week 2020. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Would those members who wish to speak in the debate please press the request to speak buttons? And I now call on Rona Mackay to open the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just say what a privilege it is to follow such a great debate and history-making legislation. So well done, Monica Lennon, and everyone involved in getting that bill passed. So this isn't the ideal way to lead a member's debate, but we're living in extraordinary times and needs must when you live in a level four area. Anyway, I'm delighted to be able to lead this debate. Thank all members across the chamber who signed my adoption week, which was it's never too late to highlight the amazing work being done by our adoption organisations and especially as Scottish Adoption Week was celebrated last week. Presiding Officer, as well as providing information about adopting, this year the themes focused on ships, therapeutic parenting and fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, or FASD. Took part in an excellent member SD host. These events had to be planned online for Scottish Adoption Week, but huge congratulations must go to the organisers, the Adoption and Fostering Alliance Scotland, who worked their socks off to make the programme enjoyable and
We seem to have a problem with the connection to Rona Mackay. I will suspend for a moment and see if we can sort that connection. This meeting is suspended. informed Rona Mackay may now be in a position to recommence her speech.
Okay, I'm not sure if people hear me.
I am assured that the connection is now good. Can I ask Rona Mackay, would you mind starting again? We will give you the full time and allow you to move the motion at the end of your speech.
I think you probably heard the first few paragraphs, so I'll just go back a few to save time. So, like everything else this year, activities and events had planned online for Scott Adoption Week, but huge congratulations must go to the organisers, the Adoption and Fostering Alliance Scotland, who worked their socks off to make the programme enjoyable and informative as always, despite the unusual circumstances. There was a week of fantastic virtual events, including a Q&A with Ministers Marie Todd and Joe Fitzpatrick, special message from the First Minister and legal advice from Rona Pollock. Great fun was had at family events, including a magic show and gymnastics, information sessions, a DIY tea party kit for hosting your own celebration, and much more. There were sessions of attachment and relationship trauma, FASD and sibling webinars, adoption and fostering podcasts, among others. In fact, I can't believe how much was packed into just 1 week. And it continues. Just look on the Adoption Scotland website to see what's happening over the next few weeks. Presiding Officer, I don't have time to detail the terrific podcast on the Adoption Scotland website, but I urge you to visit the site and listen to some heartwarming and realistic, no-holds-barred accounts of some amazing adopters. Talking of amazing adopters, I would like to highlight a personal story of a friend and a member of my staff team who many people in Parliament know. He and his husband 18 when 18 months old, and their interaction skills. Around a month later, I saw him again, and even in that short time, he was a different little boy, responding to his name, coming over for cuddles, doing all the things children do. Right in front of me, I saw proof of the difference attachment and nurture makes. Shortly after, the couple found out that the birth parents were pregnant with their second child. They decided to adopt their son's sister from birth to enable the siblings to be together. Sure, there were hiccups along the way, as they were initially told no, as this wasn't policy and hadn't been done before. Thankfully, a few months later, it was agreed that they could be approved as foster carers, and they brought the little girl home to be with her brother. They tell me this was a first for Glasgow adoptees. Fast forward to today, and they're moving forward with the adoption. They're a loving family unit devoted to their two healthy, happy children. And as if there wasn't enough toilet training to contend with, they've even added an adorable puppy to their family. Apart from the obvious joy of this story, I tell it to illustrate that adoption can be an unpredictable and bumpy journey, and that, of course, it's possible to keep siblings together. And the one thing to remember is that professional and friendly support is always there for any situation that arises. Presiding Officer, children who are placed away from their home require high quality care that addresses their emotional and well-being needs. Matching children to families who can provide this is essential to supporting improved outcomes for children. Every child deserves a secure and happy home. Foster care and adoption services are vital in assessing, approving and supporting foster carers and prospective adoptive parents to care for some of our most vulnerable children. Ongoing assessment and planning are crucial for the child and for the families. The Care Inspectorate report for 2018-19 stated that there were 3,758 approved foster care households at the end of 2018, a total which has gradually decreased from 4,414 in 2015. In 2018, 286 children and young people were legally adopted, down from 328 in 2017. There were 280 new adoptive households approved in 2018, again down from 317 in 2017. Of the new adoptive households, 28% were approved to adopt sibling groups of two, 2% were approved for sibling groups of three, and none were approved to adopt sibling groups of four or more. Presiding Officer, adoption can be a long process, but that's for good reason. However, there are ways, I believe, that it could be better streamlined, and a national framework might be the starting point. The Minister might want to allude to that in her closing speech. There's a wealth of information on the process online, and there are many documented statistics around adoption and fostering. But, Presiding Officer, the message is clear. Children need a loving home. Fostering can provide that temporarily, and there's a desperate need for more foster families. Adoption is a longer route, not without its challenges, but the rewards far outweigh those challenges, knowing that your love and nurture have helped a child to flourish. Because who doesn't believe that every child should have the best chance in life and that every child deserves love and support regardless of their background? So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I look forward to hearing contributions from members and thank everyone again for supporting this debate, and apologies for the technical problems we appear to be having. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I now call Jamie Halker-Johnson to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I congratulate Rona Mackay for bringing this debate to the Chamber following what was an important week for us to reflect on the work on a whole range of bodies that support children, as well as the work of adoptive parents and of the children themselves who are adopted. As with so many other services, this year has created additional problems for individuals and organisations. The current pandemic is far-reaching, as Rona Mackay's motion suggests. And it's right that we use this time to consider challenges, but also to celebrate the good work that has taken place and to encourage more people to consider whether adoption might be the right choice for them. Because many of the things that benefit the system today are still relatively new. It's only in this century that statutory adoption leave has found its place alongside statutory maternity and later paternity leave. It was only in this decade that a government-supported Scotland-wide adoption register emerged. Within our lifetimes, many negative practices remained in place for looked-after children, and the Education and Skills Committee has only recently been looking at redress for survivors of abuse, a great many of them left in the care of institutions that simply didn't address their needs, failed to protect them, and wouldn't listen to them. We see too often a high cost in lives for the failures of the past. Because many looked-after children and adopted children have faced far too many negative experiences at a young age. Increasingly, we have recognised that adoption can only be the beginning in providing a stable home environment and taking care of the needs of the child. As Adoption Week this year recognises, we still see sibling groups split up by these processes. At least 1,300 children have suffered this heartbreaking fate across the UK since April 2018. We now rightly see that it's in the best interest of these family groups to stay together. But sadly, and too often, that appears not to be seen as a viable option. Adoption can be a difficult process for prospective parents too. For many, becoming an adoptive parent is the end of a long period of preparation and engagement with local services. From assessment to matching, it can be a tough and sometimes disheartening path. I do hope and I do believe that ministers are mindful of these issues. There is undoubtedly a strong balance between finding the right people to adopt, matching them appropriately, and ensuring at all stages the appropriate safeguarding has taken place to protect the child's best interests. There are all too many cases, however, where people have faced unnecessary delays, often administrative. If anything, these timescales are more important to the child who stands at the centre of this, and few would doubt the positive effects of stability and permanence that adoption can bring. A cliche often heard from parents that children grow up too fast is as true of looked after children as anyone else. Their development is important, and past trauma can be compounded by a system that is slow moving or where there simply are not enough families willing and ready to adopt. This would be true of any child, but as we know, looked after children are more likely to have faced trauma or to require additional support, love and care. And as we have heard, one of the focuses of Adoption UK Scotland this year is on fetal alcohol syndrome, a condition that can cause a whole range of learning difficulties, damage to a child's body, and ongoing additional needs throughout life on a broad spectrum of disability. Deputy Presiding Officer, often the process of adoption is another problem placed on children who are already struggling with a wide range of challenges and can follow long periods where their needs are often not being met. For children who have multiple support needs, the task of helping them can be difficult. It can be expensive, but faced with the consequences where those needs go unmet, we should surely be driven to redouble our efforts in ensuring that every child in Scotland receives the sort of support that they need. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Mary Fee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to congratulate my colleague Rona Mackay for bringing this important motion and debate to the Chamber tonight. Adoption is a huge decision for a family, couple or individual to make. However, the work done by all those involved in the organisation of Adoption Week 2020 does so much to demystify the process. All children deserve the best possible start in life through continued efforts to support adopters and encourage more people to consider adoption. We can ensure that children receive the care and support they need to achieve their full potential. In 2018, 286 children and young people were legally adopted across Scotland, with a further 194 approved for adoption and waiting to be matched to an adoptive household. Every successful adoption requires a great deal of work from adoption services and adopters, and this deserves to be acknowledged and celebrated. The Scottish Government is committed to continually improving the services, procedures and support available, and since 2011 has funded Scotland's Adoption Register, which works with and supports agencies around Scotland to give children the best chance of being matched with a family, the aim being to speed up and ultimately increase the number of adoptions in Scotland. In March this year, they celebrated the 600th match made through the register. It has now been implemented by all local authorities, and since April 2016, all adoption agencies in Scotland use it to refer children and potential adopters. A report published in July 2019 found that 90% of fostering services and 95% of adoption services were evaluated good or better by inspectors. By celebrating these successes and listening to where we can improve, we must continue to strive for a modern, responsive and child-centred adoption system which works for Scotland. Adoption can be a rewarding experience for children and young people and for their adoptive families. That said, there are unique challenges which come with adoption. As part of Adoption Week, organisers from Adoption UK in Scotland and the Adoption and Fostering Alliance put together a range of information sessions. The week featured also fun, family-focused events, such as a virtual family disco and storytelling sessions. Such a wide range of events not only provides support for those navigating the long and often emotional process of adoption, although it certainly does that, it is also an unrivalled opportunity for children and families at all stages of their adoption journey to get to know each other. The formal and informal support networks arising from these events are a vital part of making the adoption process easier and more accessible. Whether this is learning from those who have been through the process or giving advice to others who are just starting off. It may even just be letting off steam to someone who knows what you're going through. It's these informal networks and events which help so many through the hardest parts of a deeply and necessarily formalised process. Having worked to increase awareness of fetal alcohol spectrum disorders through my own debate in September, I'm pleased to see it was one of this year's themes for Adoption Week. FASD is by no means unique to care experience or adopted children. However, looked after children or adopted children are at significantly increased risk, with 75% of children referred for adoption having a history of alcohol exposure during pregnancy. FASD has a profound and lifelong effects on sufferers, with an estimated 90% suffering mental health problems, 79% experience unemployment, and 60% experiencing significant disruption to their school life. Inadequate support and misdiagnosis further increase the impact of FASD. Incredibly, people who are cognitively impaired to the degree of a formal learning disability often have better outcomes than those with less severe symptoms, as their needs are identified earlier. It's therefore hugely encouraging that FASD awareness is taking centre stage in this way. Presiding Officer, Adoption Week featured specific events for professionals and for prospective parents and offered insight into FASD from social work, education and parental perspectives. By bringing into the conversation around adopting and raising children, potential parents, professionals and the wider community have been given the tools to recognise the signs of FASD. This also gives those who need it the opportunity to seek the support and diagnosis which have been so sorely lacking in the past. Presiding Officer, I again thank Rona Mackay for bringing this important debate to the Chamber this evening.
Thank you very much, and I now call Mary Fee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I begin by thanking Rona Mackay for securing this very important debate. An Adoption Week gives us the unique opportunity to both celebrate and strengthen the adoption service in Scotland. And I'm sure that everyone in the Chamber would agree that there can never be too many adoptions. In fact, it could certainly be argued that there are too few. So many families are desperate to open their hearts and their homes to children. And the pandemic has had an impact on adoption, with the process taking much longer than before. An adoption is a long and emotionally difficult experience for parents too, as they have made the necessary adaptations to their lives in order to complete the process. And I hope that we can all agree that the adoption service should be a top priority as we recover our services from this pandemic. And parents who choose to adopt are often taking on an incredibly difficult task, with over 70% of children who are adopted having experienced abuse, neglect, or trauma. And parents need all of the support that we can offer them. And organisations like Adoption UK and Scotland are doing excellent work to provide both resources and help. But adoption is very rewarding. And when parents are loving and nurturing and use techniques such as therapeutic reparenting, children can often begin to recover from their experiences and go on to live happy and stable lives. And one area that I would like to highlight is the adoption of older children. And the statistics from the 2019 Care Inspectorate report highlight that in 2017-18, of the 280 households that were approved for adoption, only 1% were approved for children older than 11. And less than 5 children older than 11 were adopted. And we know from evidence that children who are adopted experience far more positive outcomes in terms of health, education, and their well-being. And children who are not adopted usually spend the rest of their childhood in care, and this can be tumultuous for them. And the transition from being in care to being an independent person is incredibly difficult, and it has been so even more so during the last 8 months. And Who Cares Scotland have been carrying out invaluable work during the pandemic, and their most recent report makes for uncomfortable reading. They saw an increase in care-experienced individuals using their advocacy services over lockdown, with many of them struggling with poverty as they make the transition into independent adulthood. We need to ensure that more financial and emotional support and education is provided to care-experienced individuals as we come out of this pandemic. And in closing, Presiding Officer, I want to commend all parents of adoptive children, the organisations that work so hard to sustain the adoption service and support the users, organisations like Who Cares Scotland for the work that they do to provide support to young people in care and to children who use many of their services. And I hope that we can continue to strengthen the adoption service and celebrate the ways in which it radically changes children's lives for the better. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I now call on Marie Todd to wind up the debate on behalf of the Government Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to start by thanking Rona Mackay for securing this debate, and I welcome the opportunity to make the closing remarks. She mentioned a framework in her opening speech, and I'm very, very happy to explore that. I couldn't hear her terribly clearly, so I'd be very grateful if she would write to me and I will explore that issue with stakeholders. I did hear her, though, when she was mentioning the family of her employee, and I was delighted that she raised the issue of that landmark process where her employee was able to take care of his wee boy's baby sister from birth and keep those two siblings together. I think that's an excellent story to raise during this debate. The adoption sector, like all parts of our society, have been challenged by the pandemic, but adoptive children, parents, foster carers, and social workers have been inspiring in the way that they have risen to that challenge. I want to thank Adoption UK Scotland and the Adoption and Fostering Alliance for the wonderful timetable of events that they delivered last week. The purpose of the week is to raise awareness of adoption and the difference it's making to the lives of thousands of people across the country, and I want to congratulate everyone involved for making it a success. We've heard this evening of discussion of the Return to School survey report, and in recognising the challenges that many care experienced children and young people face over recent months, our Return to School guidance prioritised a young person's wellbeing as part of their plans to ensure appropriate support was in place. We've also allocated a further $135 million over the next 2 years to tackle the impact of coronavirus in our schools. And that will include investment in teaching resources and other work to support children and young people's health and wellbeing and attainment. This funding is in addition to the $33 million over this parliamentary term provided via the Care Experience Children and Young People Fund. This fund supports initiatives and interventions aimed at improving educational outcomes for care experienced children and young people. And we know that some local authorities are using the funding to develop inclusion services to reduce exclusions. Others are using the funding to deliver mentoring programmes alongside targeted and individualised support to children and young people and their families at the right time by the right person. This debate provides a very welcome opportunity to raise awareness of the challenges that many adoptive families face, and also to highlight some of the work underway in relation to the three main themes of Adoption Week. Those are fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, therapeutic parenting, and siblings. Fetal alcohol spectrum disorder is a lifelong neurodevelopmental condition which is caused by prenatal alcohol exposure. And it affects the development of the brain and the body, and it's estimated that 3% of the population are affected. But awareness of this condition remains low, and that's why we recently launched the NHS Education for Scotland resource to support practitioners' understanding. Last Wednesday, along with Minister for Public Health, Sport and Wellbeing, I took part in an Adoption Week event which focused on areas of importance for families, which included FASD. It was a really powerful session that raised lots of issues that lots of families are facing and highlighted the need for families to get the right support at the right time. And that's why our support for the Adoption UK Scotland FASD Hub is so important. The Hub is a tiered support service for all parents and carers of children and young people who've been affected or might have been affected by prenatal alcohol exposure. The Scottish Government is committed to preventing and mitigating the impact of childhood adversity and trauma, and I know that this is an issue that Mary Fee has pursued throughout her time in Parliament. We're developing a trauma-informed and trauma-responsive workforce right across Scotland that can help to minimise distress, overcome barriers and build trust. Since 2018, we have invested over $1.5 million in a national trauma training programme to support all sectors of the workforce to train and support staff in trauma-informed practice, as well as to embed and sustain this model of working. Supporting brothers and sisters to maintain relationships is a key priority for the Scottish Government, and that's why I was so pleased to hear my colleague Rona Mackay raise that story. The Children Scotland Act imposes a duty on local authorities to promote personal relationships between a child who has been taken into care and their siblings where it's in their best interests. Work to commence in these provisions of the Act is underway, and preparations are also underway to create a new statutory provision in favour of brothers and sisters who are taken into care being placed together where it's in their best interest. And while there has been great progress made in adoption services in Scotland, we are aware of the challenges that remain, and research such as Permanently Progressing and the Adoption Barometer have shown that there is drift and delay in our systems. We are absolutely clear that when a child is not able to remain with their birth parents, decisions around permanence should be made as quickly as possible, and always with the best interests of the child at their heart. Prospective adopters quite rightly go through a rigorous assessment, which can take time, but we need to make sure that the assessment is both robust and timely so that children are placed in the security of their adoptive families without delay. Presiding Officer, adoptive families across Scotland are providing the love and the security that children deserve, and it is important that they receive the support that they need when they need it most. The report of the Independent Care Review made it clear that adoption has an important role in providing permanent, loving, nurturing homes, and that adoption must continue to be supported in policy and planning. The promise specified that an adoption placement should not be the conclusion of the support offered to adoptive families, and importantly, that the burden on obtaining support must not primarily be placed on adopting parents. They should be able to be part of reflective practices, supervision, and peer support. In accepting the conclusions contained within the promise, the First Minister committed this government to work with all of its energy and focus alongside partners and stakeholders to make the changes that the review considered necessary. This year's programme for government outlined the early steps that we're taking to ensure that we keep our promise to those with lived experience. In closing, I want to reiterate our commitment to delivering the promise alongside incorporation of UNCRC to ensure a rights-based approach to meeting the needs of all young people. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I now close this meeting.